It all looked so promising for Princess Margaret and Anthony Armstrong Jones when they tied the knot in May 1960, in the first royal wedding to be broadcast on television. But when the relationship turned sour, Margaret turned to comfort in the arms of others. In the 1960s, she was rumoured to have been romantically linked to the likes of Mick Jagger, David Niven, and Warren Beatty, before reaching the 1970s and settling into a long-term relationship with landscape gardener Roddy Llewellyn. Little did Margaret know what was around the corner in 1978, her first annus horribilis. I'm Anita Rani, and this is Beneath the Crown. 1978 began with an old flame flickering back into public view. Painful wounds were reopened when Peter Townsend released his autobiography in February, Time and Chance. It covered his romance with Margaret and their ill-fated plans for marriage in the 1950s. That same month, another book hardly did wonders for Margaret's morale. The growing perception of her as an unfulfilled, directionless, and disastrous figure was reinforced by the publication of biography Margaret, the Tragic Princess. In May, her divorce from Tony was finalised.
He was never the right man for you.
Margaret and Tony's divorce was the first divorce of a senior royal since King Henry VIII and Anne of Cleves over 438 years earlier. However, it paved the way for public acceptance of royal divorce, which was to prove hugely beneficial to her sister's children. The divorce generated plenty of negative publicity for Margaret. Neither the public all the royal family were on her side, although Tony refused to say a bad word about her, which only made the royals like him more. Life with her current lover, Roddy Llewellyn, was far from plain sailing. Amidst plenty of public criticism for their relationship and its 17-year age gap, the tabloids branding Roddy a toy boy, his attempt to launch a pop career did not go to plan. To make matters worse, Margaret had to battle a number of health issues throughout the year. In May, she was hospitalised with both gastroenteritis and hepatitis, and in October, she contracted viral pneumonia. To round off this horrible year, Tony remarried in December to Lucy Lindsay Hogg. Margaret managed to recover from her health woes, for the time being at least, and navigated 1979 without too much drama. Could the advent of a new decade finally bring her the happiness she craved?
Well, I've come to the view that there is no right man for me.
Sadly for Margaret, 1980 brought an end to her romance with Roddy. Margaret still craved male companionship, with a romantic element not essential. And there started a period where she was seen out and about with what became known as her walkers, a procession of men who would accompany her to public engagements, such as the ballet or theatre trips. This was to be the source of plenty of speculation from the tabloids. Amongst her walkers in the early 80s was Ned Ryan, a self-made Irish property developer. Then there was Norman Lonsdale, an Eton-educated businessman who was spotted kissing Margaret. Marriage was even rumoured to be on the cards, although this was refuted as absolute rubbish by the princess. Dashing civil servant Derek Dazzle Jennings was also on Margaret's radar. She was believed to be infatuated with him, but it was not meant to be. Margaret treasured Dazzle's company, and that was taken away from her when he pursued his desire to become a priest and move to Rome.
There was a time when the men I loved would simply leave me for other women. Now they leave me for the church.
And then came Margaret's second annus horribilis in 1985. The heavy years of smoking had taken their toll. In January 1985, Margaret had part of her left lung removed, a dreadful parallel with her father's tragic illness. It turned out to be a non-malignant growth, but brought on more poor health and saw her number of royal engagements slashed.
I am ready for a new chapter without men, without cigarettes.
But this period wasn't all doom and gloom for Margaret. A positive and much-needed constant in her life was her favourite holiday spot, Mustique, a small private island in the West Indies she regularly retreated to. It was a place to convalesce and a place to party. She had a private residence, Les Jolies Eaux, beautiful waters, on a 10-acre plot of land. This would be the only home she would ever own. All her other property belonged to the state or the crown. Margaret's relationship with her well-rounded children, David and Sarah, also provided some stability. The passage from 1978 to 1985 was a tough one for Margaret to navigate, bookended by serious health issues. Past events had taken their toll, as had her hedonistic and nocturnal lifestyle. Smoking, drinking, partying, men, all seemed to be distractions from the inner hurt she carried. The men she loved, Peter Townsend, Anthony Armstrong Jones, and Roddy Llewellyn, had all found happiness in the arms of others. What now for Margaret?
Love has a tender kiss for most people. For me, she saves her sharpest axe